Invisible College website, the World Congress on the Law of Time and Judgment Day Tribunal, held in Tokyo, Japan last summer, the Vatican Peace Strategy, and a North American kin gathering that was held in Portland. Diplomatic efforts under the umbrella of the World 13-Moon Calendar Change Peace Plan and the ongoing planetary moral emergency have resulted in the New World Calendar Reform Peace Pact, culminating in the creation of the World Ecumenical Council for the Theology of Peace and the Great Calendar Change, July 26, 1998. And compared to 5 years ago, at this moment, we are here with the announcement of this movement being a planetary and world phenomenon which has not been covered by any mainstream press in the United States of America. But we understand this because this is revolution. And we are talking about a change in time, a return to natural time, which states that our current institutional forms are embedded in the old time, the time of the 1260 timing frequency, where the 12-month calendar takes time and divides it into uneven months, which do not correspond to any natural rhythm. Every woman on the planet knows that we have been given a biological birthright in the rhythm we carry in our bodies in the 28-day menstruation cycle. And we live at a moment in time when women are here on the planet holding an incorrect timing frequency, which has put us at war within ourselves. So we are at a critical moment in time where if we go back into the natural timing frequency that we were born with, woman's inherent power will be reestablished in her being, and when the woman is in order, the house and home and our children will also be returned to a harmony, which is inconceivable in this world at this moment. As you know, we have an outbreak of incredible violence in our world, and only by a return to a natural timing frequency can we expect to see peace on this planet. I would like to now introduce my husband, who is well known to all of you as Jose Arguelles, who prepared the Harmonic Convergence, whose face was on the front of the Wall Street Journal at that time and in every major news magazine. And that event was a very critical opening event. And it has now been over 10 years. And at this point, we are here to say that Harmonic Convergence was the opening of the door of the new frequency. And everyone should remember again what has happened in the world in the last 10 years and think about what it means to live in natural time. My husband is a man of knowledge, and he carries very, very deep templates of a whole system order, a whole system perspective for the planet for this moment in time.
Thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. I'm glad to see as many of you people here, so it looks like the room will pretty much hold, which is very good. I'm very happy that there's so much interest in whatever it is that we might have to say here. damaging the biosphere. And when species is actually causing a conflict of a very, very disastrous nature to this biosphere. And there's only one species that is operating on its own timing frequency and not on the natural timing frequency. And the answer to both those questions is that it's the human species that is causing the damage to the biosphere, and it's the human species that alone that is living according to an artificial timing frequency. This is our analysis, which we proposed to test by visiting as many places on the planet as we could and bringing to them common sense. We all ask for equal standards when we have units of measure. If someone was to give you a ruler and the inches were uneven units, 30, 31, 30, 30, 31, etc., why would you use that? If someone gave you a measuring stick and said, this meter is 97 meters and this meter is 104 centimeters, would you use that to build a house? And if you did, what would that house be like? This is common sense. We expect a standard of measure when we deal with space, but we do not understand time at all. We think that the standard of measure in time is the hour, the 60-minute hour, and the 12-month year, but that is those are standards of measure that are artificial, that are illogical, that are erroneous, and the fact of the matter, since time is of the mind, this creates quite a mess of our mind. Because when we give our mind irregular feedback, erroneous feedback, feedback that is illogical and inconsistent with nature, and we create what we call a civilization that is absolutely at odds with nature. The only species, as I said, who is causing damage to this environment is the human species, and the human species does not have really a clue how to really begin to take full responsibility for what it is doing. In 1994, after testing out this thesis, this hypothesis, this theory, it was clear to us, it had been clear to us from the inception, that the first step that the human species had to take, if it wanted to reform itself in time, or like it says in the hexagram of the I Ching, to set the calendar in order, that we had to set the calendar in order would be the first step to correcting this situation. To set the calendar in order, we realized, was no easy thing. Whereas the Gregorian calendar is dogma, because no one questions it nor wants to question it. As we found out, it's absolutely true. People would either say, you're crazy, you're nuts, or would be to shut the door and be too threatened to deal with it. So it is true. The Gregorian calendar is dogma because no one questions it and no one wants to question it. From this position, we gave birth in 1994, when we were in the office of Robert Mueller at the University for Peace in Costa Rica, to the World 13-Moon Calendar Change Peace Movement. We said, well, we have to create a movement. We have to go around the world and see if there's a movement of people who can transcend nationalism, who can transcend ideology, who can understand common sense and say, yes, it's worth a try. It's a very pragmatic and practical move. If you want to really make a change, try changing your calendar and living by a calendar that's correct. It is a definite change. Okay. We proposed this change to many people. We traveled around the world and proposed this to many people. And within a matter of 4 years, we have established a worldwide movement of people who are now living by the correct timing standard, a movement that is growing, that is very strong, particularly in Japan, that is very strong in the grassroots here of North America, is particularly strong in South America, in Brazil, Chile, Argentina in particular, is now spreading throughout Central America as well as Mexico, and is also spreading throughout Europe. The Islamic world has also taken a great interest in this calendar at very, very not that existed before this calendar was the institution that authorized this calendar, and that is the Vatican. All government institutions that exist today, virtually all of them, are post-Gregorian calendar, are 1260 frequency institutions, banking institutions, government institutions, all, and of course, all of industrial civilization. The Industrial Revolution did not begin until after the Scientific Revolution. If there had been, if the clock had not been mechanized, there would be no machines. The clock was the first machine. In the 17th century, they said God is a clockmaker. The universe is a perfect clock. And the scientists took their cue from that particular point. So we realized if you're going to have a new calendar, you need a new covenant, and so we created the Congress of the First Planetary Congress of Biospheric Rights, said that all the other species have biospheric rights. They have, and what are those biospheric rights? That's the right to clear, pure air, clean, pure water, land that does not need to be bought or sold. The human species is the only species that pays to be born, that pays to live, and pays to die. It exacts a terrible, terrible retribution for not living by this standard. We have been fortunate. Our scientific experiment demanded of us that we live, if the philosophy of the 1260 is time is money, then to test our hypothesis that you can, that there is such a thing as a natural timing frequency where time is not money, that we have lived our experiment outside of the money system. We have lived by the grace of others who have believed in what we were doing and who supported us out of love and cooperation. I have no credit cards. I have no bank account. I do not have a driver's license. I am not a part of this 1260 system. I had to get out of it, not because I necessarily didn't like it or I don't like having comfort or anything like that, but in order to test this experiment, I had to, and to be as objective as I could, but I had to release from all of those different forms of what we call identity. Okay? So this is not about anything like that. This is not a concept. This is not an idea. This is not anything that we wish you to validate or to not validate. This is a message, and the message is that the human species is living in the wrong timing frequency. It is creating a great, great, great disturbance on this planet. It is in the process of destroying itself by disrupting its biosphere so drastically that the options for life will very, very soon be at a very diminished level. Certainly the collapse of civilization is imminent. It's imminent, can be taken to mean any time in the next 20 years, which in the cycle of all of human history is imminent, and in the cycle of the biosphere is very imminent. In fact, we have undoubtedly already closed off many of our options. And following the 1996 Congress of Biospheric Rights, we convened in Japan the World Congress on the Law of Time and the Judgment Day Tribunal. The Judgment Day Tribunal, we defined the crime of the millennium as being the crime that was initiated by the Vatican, by Pope Nicholas V in 1452 under the Doctrine of Discovery, which states that if a Christian finds a land that's owned by a non-Christian, the Christian has the right to possess that land. 40 years later, Christopher Columbus, a paid agent, was sent to test that doctrine. He found land to test the doctrine, which is all North, Central, and South America as we know it today. Within 90 years of the time of Christopher Columbus and 130 years from the time of the Doctrine of Discovery came the final piece that completed the crime of the millennium, and that was the Gregorian calendar, which was an edict of Pope Gregory XIII. The edict was created in 1572 and was enacted in 1582. It's very important to understand that the edict of the Gregorian calendar, which was a very, very minor reform of the already existing Julian calendar, that edict was completely dependent on the absolute destruction of all the civilizations and cultures of the New World, and in particular Nicaeus in 1494 shows that the Vatican neatly divided the world into two parts, the Portuguese part and the Spanish part. And that's the whole world that was divided in that way. So we created the Judgment Day Tribunal, brought this evidence to light. We had with us present at that tribunal a Catholic priest from South America who came to bear silent witness to this matter. And from that point, we initiated our process of finally going to the Vatican itself. We had sent a number of directives to Pope John Paul II since 1993, informing him of what we were doing. And I am just a plain warner, as like the warners of old. I have no illusions about anyone liking what I have to say. I have no illusions about anyone even wanting to listen to me. But it's my responsibility with the truth to deliver this truth. And it's especially important in my responsibility to deliver this truth to the doors in the office of where the error in time had finally been perpetrated, and that was in the Vatican with Gregory XIII. So on January 1st of this year, we went to the Vatican with a team of lawyers that we have working with our movement from Brazil. Incidentally, the movement is very large in Brazil. And right now, the Brazilian government is considering this flag right here, if you want to just hold that up for a minute. The Brazilian government is considering reinstating the banner of peace and having a peace through culture day on July 25th, the day out of time, which will be effective this year. Our efforts have been very strong in that country there. Anyway, with several lawyers from Brazil, we were at the Vatican. We met with the private secretary of the Pope, and through also met with the director of the Vatican Observatory, which is that's fine. That's the way it's supposed to be. We met with the director of the Vatican Observatory, both at Castel Gandolfo in Italy and also in Arizona, where the Vatican has an observatory. It's also planning another observatory on Mount Graham. The Vatican is very interested in extraterrestrial phenomena, so it tries to keep that undercover. And this is why they have their observatories. Through that process, we also obtained the names of every single functionary and dignitary of the Vatican, from everyone from the keeper of the secret archives to the deputies of state, to the permanent ambassadors of the United Nations, the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, and so on. And late, about 6 weeks ago, we had a major operation, which we referred to as Operation Fax, in which we sent to the Vatican the final statement that we had to make about this. In 1962, at the end of the Ecumenical Council known as Vatican II, the Vatican issued a declaration of calendar reform. They never followed that up. In their declaration of calendar reform, that they said that they were not opposed to a new perpetual civil calendar that maintains Sunday. Well, this is precisely what the 13-moon calendar is. It is a perpetual civil calendar. The first day of every 52 weeks is a Sunday, and this is the same every single year. This is what the calendar, what the Vatican was looking for in 1962. We sent this document back to the Vatican, said that you made this word in 1962, that you were willing to change the calendar, and we have the right calendar change for you. It's 2 years before the millennium, and it's a good time to think about it. The United Nations in 1956 also considered the calendar reform and adjourned debate on it, and we had sent from Hiroshima on Hiroshima Day last year in Japan, we sent letters to Pope John Paul II, to Mr. Kofi Annan of the United Nations, and to President Clinton of the United States, informing them of what we were doing and letting them know that this was the truth and that it was in their best interest to consider it. The only people, of the three people, the only one who considered Social Council in 1956 when the Council decided to adjourn debate on the matter indefinitely. Although no evaluation or study of a new calendar is being contemplated, you may wish to submit your proposal to the permanent mission of the United States, to the United Nations, etc., which we have done. We've also made two more appeals to Mr. Kofi Annan on this matter. When in 1995 we received from UNESCO, from the Secretary General of UNESCO, interest in the calendar, which states, on behalf of the Director General, I thank you for your letter and the attached documents, which we have examined very attentively, and we commend you on your activities in favor of peace. The UNESCO was interested in that time in a conference they were trying to put together in Costa Rica, but which did not occur. This document I'd like to share with you, part of the document, the last document that we wrote to the Vatican, we did receive from the Pontifical Academy of Sciences recognition of the discovery of the law of time, because after, I must say that after 7 or 8 years of our experiment, we were able to definitively state that yes, there is a law of time. One aspect of the law of time states that there are the artificial timing frequency and the natural timing frequency, the 1260 and the 1320 timing frequency, and that this has incumbent in it a moral, historical, and evaluative component, that the human race is operating on an irregular standard and at this point is running a totally immoral course in its behavior with regard to itself and with regard to the rest of the biosphere. And the other aspect of the law of time is the absolute aspect that says that the formula or the understanding of the law of time is summed up by the statement or the equation or the formula energy factored by time equals R, where time is the 1320 timing frequency. Social and industrialization. Only a shift of the natural 1320 timing frequency represented by the natural 1328 day calendar will begin to alter this situation in order to avoid a catastrophic biospheric collapse. This is the scientific mandate. To declare that all of humanity is living an error in time that allowed to run its course would be the cause of the imminent collapse of the planetary life support system is to evoke Judgment Day. If there were no false time, there would be no Judgment Day. The knowledge of the timing frequencies and its pragmatic implementation as the New World Calendar reform is therefore also a divine fiat. To heed it is to adhere to truth and divine order. To ignore it is to go against the truth, which is inseparable from divine command. This is the theological mandate. Now, we had sent this to probably 50 or 60 or 70 few people within the Vatican, heeding them at the end to send it also with their own declaration of calendar reform as well as the United Nations calendar reform. We sent all this information to them, also informing them that there was no longer any need to hesitate on this reform and in advance of the Y2K year 2000 computer failure, the calendar reform is the pretext for a spiritual peace plan to be supervised by a World Ecumenical Council for the Theology of Peace. Let your spiritual conscience be aroused that the Holy Father, the Pope himself, may announce to the world this urgent spiritual and universal peace plan. Well, the Pope spoke out 2 weeks after we had sent this. He spoke out publicly, and this is what he had to say. He said, yes, the destiny of history is to end. We will have Judgment Day, but it is not near as many sects want us to believe. We said very clearly here, this is Judgment Day. He says, we will have Judgment Day, but it is not as near as many sects want us to believe. Not in the year 2000, he says, when we will have our Jubilee, and not before all the world has been redeemed and evangelized. I think that I'd just like to bring to your attention what happened in the Vatican 2 days ago. That this is part, this is what happens when you fly in the face of truth, and we're saying this is a divine fiat and a divine command, and we were not in the least surprised as to what happened in the Vatican 2 days ago. We knew when we read this that there was a certain amount of arrogance that the Pope was expressing, and that arrogance was going to, unfortunately, come back in his face. This is very serious stuff. A lot of people have watched this on the sidelines over the years, laughing and giggling nervously whenever we approach them. But this is very serious stuff. Like my wife said, the mainstream media in this country, and even the New Age media, and any media just about in this country, has chosen to ignore it. People have a very hard time putting into print World 13 Moon Calendar Change Peace Moon, World 13 Moon Calendar Change Peace Plan. Your calendar is erroneous and wrong. Have you ever stopped to think about it? And we're saying, if we don't stop to think about it, everyone says, well, what's that going to do for the environment? Well, I've been around a while, and I see there's some other people who are my age and even older in here. And we know what was happening in 1970, and we saw what we had in 1972 after the first Earth Day in 1970. We saw that the UN rolled up its sleeves and had the Stockholm Environmental Conference, and then didn't do another thing about it. 1990 came and everyone in Hollywood got sentimental and said, let's have another Earth Day on television. And in 1992, the UN had its Rio conference, which got totally undermined by the G7 bankers. The G7 bankers took over the world when the Berlin Wall went down. The Berlin Wall went down. justice, in the justice of events, in the dialectic of history, communism propped up capitalism, and capitalism propped up communism. And if one of them was a shell and false, the other one was a shell and false as well. But we see the one shell that fell was superseded by the other one that maintained, okay? And so now we are here 8 years after the fall of the Berlin Wall. The stock market is as high as it's ever been, outrageously, unnaturally, surreally high. Bill Gates' fortunes have gone up 50 billion% in 10 years. Time magazine said it all on its cover with the future of money when it said on the cover, will Microsoft control the money? It already does control the money. How do you think the stock market was rigged? Well, all of this is going to be ending very soon. And then soon there will be an end to money. And we are saying that the issues at stake are, have we stopped to even think whether we have another option or not? Have we stopped to consider that high tech does not have a monopoly on the future? That the cloning of ourselves and sheep and other creatures is not necessarily in the best interest of our moral future? Have we even stopped to consider whether we have any morality at all? We are floundering in an absolute morass of immorality in this country. Our public leadership is absolutely clouded by immoral behavior, by people caught in acts of immoral behavior. But we are so confused as a people in this country that we say this part is good and that part isn't good. O.J. Simpson can get off scot-free. We can execute other people in other states who are women who have committed crimes. We can have a trial for the Unabomber, and even though the Unabomber says, I'm not insane, I think industrial civilization is bad, maybe my methods are wrong, but who's manufacturing more bombs in this world? The United States of America or Saddam Hussein? But we insist that the Unabomber is insane, and rather than sentence him to death for all the people he killed, give him 4 life terms in prison. There is no standard of justice, and there's no standard of morality in this country. I may be anachronistic and outmoded for even thinking this way in some people's eyes. But that's the fact of the matter. My mission is simply to deliver to you this message and to bring you to a point of where we are. We have asked the Vatican and the United Nations to cooperate. When we were in the Vatican, we were told that if there was to be a calendar change that would be effective for the whole world, that it would have to be through the cooperation of the United Nations and the Vatican. Well, we went and did our part and put the lines together between the different dots and got all the people all the right information. Okay, we've done our part on this matter. It's now in the hands of the Vatican, who's dropping the ball very badly. And if you know Mr. Kofi Annan, please let him know that it's a rather interesting point to consider. So we have proposed, and we will go through, because we have already been following this calendar change, and there is already an evolutionary avant-garde people on this planet who have made the switch to the calendar, that we will continue to operate, and that avant-garde will continue to grow, whether it is a quote, officially recognized or not. In our eyes, what's official, what the official recognizing institutions are all erroneous anyway. They're all 1260 institutions. The National Academy of Science isn't going to recognize the discovery of the law of time. Not today, anyway. And I know that. I did get some people to understand this, but not very many people. But that doesn't matter. We're the perfect moment now to make this calendar change is this summer, July 26, 1993, when there will be a sync. When there will be a synchronization of the 13 moon calendar and the Gregorian calendar. It will be Sunday, July 26th on the Gregorian calendar. It will be Sunday, magnetic moon 1 on the 13 moon calendar, and we have a 52-week period to phase out the old calendar. We will go ahead and do this, and we are asking all other people on the planet to do this. We're asking people to be aware of this, and as I said, we have done our part and are continuing to do our part to inform the existing orders of the mandate to do this. This is an actual discovery. Don't have any doubt about that. The 1260 and the 1320 timing frequency. Don't have any doubt about the fact that we're living in an artificial virtual reality civilization that is at odds with the cycles of nature. Don't have any doubt about that. And don't have any doubt about the fact that nature has its timing cycle, which is a galactic standard. And that all we are saying is, if we want to preserve anything of our future, that we will have to become in tune with the natural cycles. Whether we do this on our own or whether we wait till Mother Nature bats last and bops us over the head and we may go the way of the dinosaurs is the question. We're saying that if we ourselves as a species can take it upon ourselves to change our own frequency, then that's a little more heroic and uplifted moral behavior than waiting for nature to bat last. That's all we're saying. And that's the very, very essence and the bottom line of what we're saying. As I said, this is a message, and this is the pretty much a statement of update of what we have done in carrying this message, and that's pretty much the sum. But I know this man over here has been dying to ask a question. Yes, sir.
Is there a relationship between the calendar you propose and the lunar Hebrew calendar?
What we are proposing is a 13 moon, that's 28 days. It's a solar lunar calendar. It's not based on the lunation cycle. The Hebrew calendar, the Arab calendar, the Japanese calendar, the Chinese calendar are based on the cycles, the actual lunation cycles of the moon. This does not, in fact, this does not at all exclude that. What we're saying is this is a synchronization calendar. Okay, we're saying all the lunar calendars can be synchronized in this calendar. What we're saying is that when the human species became unified as a global species at the end of the application of the Doctrine of Discovery in 1582, it had the wrong calendar imposed on it. We're just saying, let's get the right civil calendar, okay? And
can you explain how it relates to the other Hebrew?
Well, just the Hebrew calendar is a lunar calendar. It measures from the full moon, you know, that's all. And then that's a 29 and a half day cycle, okay? That's called the synodic, okay, lunar cycle. The sidereal lunar cycle is the 27-day cycle. The mean lunar cycle is the 28-day cycle. Okay, and that's what we're talking about, is the mean lunar cycle, which is 28 days, which creates an even standard of measure. The Hebrew calendar and the Arab calendar, the lunar calendars, are not solar calendars, because 12 lunations a year is 355 days. So the 13 moon calendar is a solar lunar calendar because 13 cycles of 28 days each is 364 days plus a 365th day, which is called no day of the week at all, day out of time, which corresponds to July 25th on the present calendar. The leap year matter, which was the basis of the Gregorian calendar, is handled in the 13 moon calendar by a 13-day jubilee every 52 years. If that answers your question. Okay, and in the 13 moon calendar, if there's a full moon, there's a periodicity of, if there's a full moon on magnetic day one, magnetic moon exactly 19 moons later, you have a full moon there. So it correlates and synchronizes the lunation cycle calendar, such as the Hebrew, the Arab, Japanese, and the Chinese.
So I just wanted to say it even more simply, that the civil calendar we currently use, being irregular, the Hebrew calendar and all the calendars we're trying to calibrate from the lunar cycles are being calibrated against an uneven basic measure that we're using. So in recalibrating, we're saying the base solar cycle of the 13 months will be regulated to such a harmony that in that consistency, then the Hebrew, all the religious calendars will be evenly tracked on the new civil calendar. That makes sense. In other words, it's not excluding all of our religious calendars. It's saying, no, the base civil calendar we're using. And actually, I think all of you in business, don't you? You already operate on a 52-week quarter-year program of 13 weeks. So there's something there. And this calendar does preserve the seven-day week. And it's a lineup of Sunday and Sunday.
I have kind of a two-part question. Is this based on a spiritual vibration? As you know, the Earth's vibration is changing. Predicted, and you mentioned a galactic, I believe, a planetary basis. So I'm wondering how these all kind of fit together.
Well, there is no separation between spirit and matter. To be in the right time is to be completely spiritual. So that's all we're talking about. We're saying that this is the fourth dimensional timing standard. This is the 13 encounter. These are even harmonic standards. Anything that's harmonic is spiritual. It's uplifting. We're also talking about what we refer to as the science and the mathematics of the third dimension, and the science and mathematics of the fourth dimension. The science and mathematics of the third dimension, which its final 20th century formulation E equals mc squared, and everything that's spun out from that, is based on the mathematics of space and also on very erroneous concepts of time. The mathematics of the fourth dimension, which Einstein said, time is the fourth dimension. But none of the scientists understood is that the mathematics of the fourth dimension time cannot be a mathematics of space. And what we discovered is that the only people who knew this in its entirety were the Maya of ancient Central America, who had a very, very sophisticated mathematical system, which was a vigesimal system and not a decimal system, a system based on 20 and not on 10. We pursued this, and this has become the basis of our understanding of what the mathematics of the fourth dimension actually is. And the fact is that this is an entirely new discovery. That's why I say people go, what, you know, what are you saying? I didn't hear that. Run that one by me again. Right, this is absolutely brand new, okay? This is shockingly brand new. So then when we're talking about the method, what we're also saying then is that we developed a civilization and earth culture. You can say we developed an earth culture on this planet through the last 5,000-year cycle of history, and particularly the last 400 years, that was based on an erroneous understanding of time. As a pure space, third-dimensional space culture resulted in the most pure form of materialism that has ever been known, probably in the universe, that we are living in right now. What we're saying is that the change in frequency, when we talk about going from 1260 to 1320, yes, that's a change in frequency, and it's going to purely mental spiritual vibration. That the evolution of the species is not the creation of more junk, of more Kmarts, of more Walmarts, of more cars, even solar-powered ones. But the evolution of the species and of the universe is a spiritual mental evolution, and we have excluded that possibility of evolution from all of our current prevailing institutions and all the ways that we think the future is supposed to be. So this is as profoundly spiritual as anything that has occurred to the human race in many, many millennia.
Alan? Yeah, Alan wants to say something. I'm kind of, you guys have been living on this system for about 5 years now, is that correct?
Yeah.
10 years.
10 years, okay. Could you describe to us how you subjectively experience time differently from those that are on the 1260 system? Is there any observations that you notice? More synchronicities, for example, that sort of thing?
Yeah, that's a very, it's a profound question, because everything comes down to the fact that as a human being, we live in time, and we can only live in the present moment, every moment in time.
Yeah.
So when you live not on a linear time frame, where you're always referencing every experience to either a past event or a future event in a linear module, you're saying what we've discovered and the tools we use bring us into an understanding that synchronicity is a universal principle, and we can actually map synchronicity in such a way to elevate our intelligence. So we're actually talking about an intelligence evolution where we no longer have spooky God. We actually could map and understand God and the whole process of divine order in a harmony that we can't know right now when we're running on the clock. So, I mean, it's so profound, and yet we don't understand how much we have given over our timing to that clock. So for us, for 10 years, you could say living subjectively, we're living without fear. I do not go to medical doctors. I do not have health insurance. I do not use credit cards. I do not use the banks in that way. I say, wait. Have you ever thought about the fact that all of the institutions are ready to take from you, but do they give back? So we're talking in nature, give and take. So in that way, we're saying we have received such a richness that it is so profound how wealthy I am, and I owe nothing. And I have never gone hungry, and always what is needed shows up when it is needed. It's a very profound reversal of the other way of living in fear. And it is a profound release from a death fear, because, you know, if we put off and say, you know, we're not going to die from this physical form, well, then we miss the spiritual cue. So back to the idea, this is a spiritual revolution, because we've been imprisoned in matter by using the clock. So that's my definition.
And I would just add to that in addition to the, what I say is the absolute increase in what people refer to as telepathy and synchronicity and phenomena like that, is that we are in the process of developing very, very specific scientific mapping of this fourth-dimensional scientific mapping, where we can now speak very specifically of the time vector potentials, how to map them, and create tools that show us that what we think of as synchronicity is actually a very, very, very harmonic orderly web that is a function of a very, very harmonic specific mathematical radial matrix of fourth dimensional mathematics. And that as I've said before, and I've said for many years, that what was the science of the fourth dimension that we are uncovering in that science, that synchronicity is to this new science what lightning is to electricity. Okay? And once we understood that, we could create the electricity, okay, we're using the same stuff that's in that lightning. Well, it's the same thing. We're creating a science of telepathy that once we have that mapped out properly, that we will channel that energy of synchronicity into a fourth dimensional science of telepathy that seems as outrageously far off right now as automobiles and refrigerators would have to somebody living at the very beginning of the Industrial Revolution.
Okay. Could you expand upon the equation time factored by energy equals art? Maybe give me more specific.
Sure. Time, this time, this is a universal constant. It's a frequency. It's a universal constant. Okay? And energy is, we are energy. Our DNA is energy. Okay? So everything that exists is a phase or a function of energy. If you look, that's how we say, wow, what a beautiful sunset. But you look at that spider web. Okay? Or even, wow, look at how that ant builds its colony. Okay? That's because they are unconsciously functioning by this equation. Everything in nature is that we can perceive is unconsciously functioning by that equation. So it's orderly. You wake up in the morning and you open the door and it's just before the sun's come up and bam, there's a blast of every bird. And then the sun goes down and the birds are, you know, they're chilled out except for the few nightbirds that then have their particular rhythm. We, as a species, have replaced this frequency with this frequency, okay? And so what we have created is an art, but entropy. We've created any number of closed systems, okay, that magnify quantitatively, and the more they magnify quantitatively, the less capacity do they have to receive new information. So that's how we arrive pretty much where we are today, in a total entropic stasis, self-saturation of the information system. So that's what we have. So we've now, with the law of time says, the discovery of the law of time makes conscious what was unconscious. You didn't know about this before. This was all unconscious to you. And we're slowly bringing it to the fore. You didn't realize before that we really were living on an artificial timing frequency. You didn't know before that the frequency that we're living on is the 1260. So we made this from the unconscious to the conscious. Now you're conscious of it. You can accept it. You can reject it. Your mind can fight it, or your mind can say, "I'll go with that." Okay. But now you know that. Okay. And so when we know that, also we also say that we have now become conscious that this, that we placed ourselves in this frequency, and therefore we have to get back to this frequency. Okay. If we want to stabilize our consciousness and even evolve and advance our consciousness. As long as we are here, as long as T equals 1260, we will just create greater and greater and greater islands of conflicting entropic mass with no resolution. So we will destroy more and more of the rest of what's operating at 1320. Right now, we know that every day we are causing species to go extinct. What does that mean? That means that our living at this frequency is canceling out the species that are living at this frequency. And that includes the Amazon forest, the forests in Indonesia. It includes all the different indigenous tribes who are continuously now in the process of even suiciding because this frequency is crowding them out. So we're saying, no, if we want to stop and have some kind of balance, we have to scientifically understand this. This isn't, you know, some theory. This isn't a workshop. Okay. I'm not getting richer from this. We're all getting poorer the less we understand this. The more we understand this, the richer we will become in spiritual diversity. Okay. So we're saying we have to get back on this frequency. When we get the first step to getting back on this frequency is the 13 moon 28 day calendar, because that'll put our bias, which is our natural biological frequency, the frequency of the human female, is 28 days, that's the natural biological frequency. When we get back to that, it'll be the first step of going back into becoming a harmonic part of this equation, which is what naturally rules the rest of the universe. But with consciousness, because now we know something we didn't know. And so because of that consciousness, we can say, yes, we have tools, we have methods, we have means of applying the fourth dimensional mathematics, which is actually the science of mathematics of telepathy, to begin to organize our lives at a telepathic. Through to new levels of thinking, penetrate the new levels. think that the fact of the matter is that the Christian civilization created the concept of the millennium. We had the first millennium in 1000, and now we have the second millennium. Okay? And that during the second millennium, the Christian civilization created the 1260, perfected, I should say, the 1260 timing frequency. So it's built in. One way or another, it was going to be built in. It's like an unconscious urge that exists within the collective psyche, you could say, of the Christian civilization. The Mayans knew about all of this too. That's why they knew that you say Christ is an Arcturian shepherd, okay, and that the point of his birth is being the point of the calendar that the world is operating on, creating this millennial point. Okay. This was known by the Maya. So they knew because their timing cycle was always fit at the end of the 1,872,000 kin count after a date that was posited back in 3113 BC, which would be the winter solstice 2012. So they knew that this was the time. That's why the harmonic convergence prophecy was called. Okay? It was the call of the end of the 13 heavens and the 9 hell cycle prophecy of Quetzalcoatl. And then it said after that, you have 25 years to 2012 and 26 years to close out in 2013 and get your galactic renewal papers. So we're just at that time. We wanted to, since the fall of the Berlin Wall and the triumph of money, people now wanted to think about these things. In fact, there's been a repression of information, especially of the information that we've been bringing through. There's been books about Mayan prophecies that are popular, but you'll notice they don't mention me. Because we're a living prophecy, and this is the truth.
I have sort of an evolving question concerning technology. Now, assuming that our electronic technology is an entropic product of following the 1260 timing frequency, would that mean that we're also going to need to give up our technology, the current state of our technology?
Well, our technology will give us up.
What do you mean by that?
Well, as we evolve, we'll find, oh, hey, I didn't need that. I'm already doing that up here.
I mean, the most extreme example is everyone having their cell phone. Well, that's the moment. That's bliss. At that moment, can you imagine? I mean, we've all become dependent on our cell phones, faxes, and so on. So that's like a scaffolding. So you say, what has that done? Well, we've globalized thought. We have simultaneous broadcast of thought around the planet. So we've gotten that part. That was like a clue. We got that. But the scaffolding has to fall away because actually telepathy is completely biospherically sound way to communicate. And our telepathy is the new frequency.
I was also going to say that, I mean, I mentioned earlier that as we understand fourth dimensional mathematics, which is the abysmal mathematics, and the law of time, that we, as I said earlier, we're going to understand how we can channel what we think of as the energy of synchronicity into the creation of new forms, actual new psychobiological forms, and we will find out that is really where the future is, not in the creation of the machines. Why is it that I need clothes and a dolphin doesn't? Why is it that I need that kind of shelter and animals, most animals don't? Well, it seems there's something genetically that we're working on that we have to learn, and that part of the entry into the fourth dimensional science and mathematics is to learn the telepathic techniques for correcting our DNA, the harmonic frequency of our DNA, so that we evolve to that stage where we may not necessarily need clothes. And we don't need clothes to think about all the industrial technology we have. Where did it begin? Cotton gin. Making clothes, okay? So we're just saying we have to realize that the evolution can take a whole other direction once we understand time correctly and once we understand how to channel the energy of one-dimensional synchronicity and telepathy correctly to create new forms of what I call psychobiological types of engineering, let's say, that is phenomenal to us today, as I said, as the automobile or the refrigerator was to somebody living in 1700.
So would you say that this new technology then is going to emerge from our own biology?
Yes. Yes.
And not an extension of the mechanical technology?
No. From our own biology. Okay. Which we have ignored. You know, we've been able to do all sorts of wonderful things in great glamour magazines from the technology we have, but we've really ignored the potential actually of our own biology. We have a couple more questions.
What's the practical application of all of this on July 26, 1988?
Take a new calendar and start living on that calendar for 52 weeks. That's a pragmatic, that's an actual change you can make, and you can see how that changes things.
Are they going to be produced?
Yes, they're being produced, and
they'll be available at Davis this weekend. Put them out. That's not just
available here right now.
We've got some here right now already. Yeah, the next year's calendar. Okay, so their calendars are being produced everywhere in the world right now for this event. Okay, so we're saying even though there may be no quote official 1260 advocation of this, but this is going ahead anyway. Okay, that was just we just had to go knock on the doors and let them know. Okay, that this is going on. Divine judgment. Divine mercy will take care of it. Now, one more question right back there.
If learning to understand the cyclic nature of our biology is what we're doing with the byproduct of telepathy and the spiritual uplifting, have you thought about the strategy of getting Bill Gates to include this calendar in the next edition of Windows? We have the choice, the option of setting their machines help them learn the rhythms.
People talk to us about that, and we have people say, hey, I got this to Bill Gates. I think someone told me they got the telecon to Bill Gates, but I don't think Bill Gates is going to listen. And I also think it's too late. We don't need another microphone.
That the civilization at the time it became a
unified global entity, as it were, or the potential for that, that it had become unified under the wrong standard of measure. And the whole basis then of modern scientific and industrial civilization was set in motion at that time. Those who know your history know that mythologically, that the key image at the time, the key mythic image at the time of the scientific revolution theologically was that God is a clockmaker, the universe is a clock. And that once God made the clock, the universe, that then he went to sleep and the scientists were then able to figure out what God had done. And so they based everything on, that's the story. They based everything on this, and from that, after a century, from Galileo and Descartes up to Newton, the time of Newton's death in 1727, that the scientific revolution was established, which is really the materialistic scientific revolution of the third dimension space science, and that established the possibility of the industrial revolution. You can go now and look at all your charts that you want of the population, what we call a population explosion, and you will notice that you have a very, very, very slow increment of increase of human population from the end of the Ice Ages up until the beginning of the 18th century. The beginning of the 18th century, when the 1260 frequency was set in motion and manifested as the Industrial Revolution, then you also have the beginning of the population explosion. Quite simply, what you're having is an unconscious acceleration of the DNA and of the human species pursuing the speed of the machine, which is very much like the Greek paradox, that story where as you go a half a distance every day, you never get to your goal. You can get it up to the nano fractal of just getting down the last half. And the human beings chasing the machines are like that, and creating an accelerating process. And you can see that by the time you get to the 20th century, then you have an exponentially rising curve that towards the end of the 20th century, in relationship to the whole process, is virtually a vertical curve. So we are, and this is all a function of the human species putting itself into the artificial timing frequency, the 1260 timing frequency. So we were as well. This is a disastrous situation. If this goes on like that, we will consume all the resources of the biosphere in the process, because the effect of the 1260 timing frequency was to create a civilization that is materially, technologically dependent on the depletion of natural resources for the sake of monetary profit of a few. So this is why. If you look at it, then, well, when was the first stock exchange? No, that was about 1720. So that came hand in hand with this. The concept of the stock exchange as a market of speculation on commodities and new technologies. Okay. So, and then that, all of that is one whole piece, which gives rise to the adage, the ruling philosophy of the 1260 timing frequency is time is money. And this is never more absolutely true than it has been since the end of the Cold War, or as we say, communism lost and the dollar won. And since that time, as we know, the New York Stock Exchange has tripled at least, or maybe close to quadrupled from what it was less than 10 years ago. All of that since the end of the Cold War, and of course the co-opting of the New World Order by the G7, the Group of Seven. Most industrialized nations, which took over power after being a covert operation formed by the CIA in 1974 by Mr. Bush, who was president in 1991, the G7 then became a covert power. But we saw immediately all of this, and we saw, well, the first thing we have to do is we have to get the human race to change its timing frequency. The first step we have to do is get rid of this bad calendar and get on the right calendar. We saw immediately that the correct calendar was the biologically accurate frequency of the 13 moon 28 day calendar, absolutely even unit of measure. It's a solar lunar calendar. It's the mean, the 28 days, the mean cycle between the 27 and that point odd day, synod inclination cycle on the 29 and a half day, excuse me, 27 point odd day, sidereal cycle on the 29 and a half day, synodic cycle, the mean cycle on that 28 days, which is also the human-female biological rhythm, and so that's the correct biological timing cycle that we're supposed to be on if we want to be in phase with nature and not destroy nature. So that was very, very simple type of logical common sense to us. The result of that was that we knew that we had to put together that calendar. We saw that there was a very simple form of this calendar, the 13 moon calendar, which takes the form of like the form constant, the 13 unit fourth dimensional form constant, which we call the wave spell, and which has 13 units there, one unit each for each of the moons, and the calendar is perpetual. Every month is exactly the same, so you can, this is the simplest representation of it. It's like this, we said, well, that's the natural perpetual civic calendar that the human race should be on, and we want to get the human race to get rid of the Gregorian calendar to get on that calendar. In the process of doing that, we had a tremendous amount of breakthroughs, very explosive, and the dream spell was the final codification of the first stage of our understanding of the radio mathematics, radio radically non-linear holographic mathematics of the fourth dimension. This is the map of the 260-day cycle. It's all fractal mathematics. Each unit there is called a kin, and a kin can be either a day, a moon, a year. You can fractal up that unit. That's also, you can see that in this way, that's what we mean by non-linear and holographic map of time. This is also, again, this shows the mathematical, there are 20 base units or icons, each of which corresponds to one of the numbers of 0, 19, and we found out that each of those has a set of constant relationships to all of the other sets, all the other units within that set of 20, and then those are mapped, when they're mapped out, they look like this. Each of the units, of the 20 units, which has a code number 0 to 19, has an antipode, which is always 10 units apart, has an analog with added to, which always adds up to 19, has an occult added to, which always adds up to 21, and they cover each other perfectly well. There are, when you put the color permutation set in there, then you always have the possibility of one of five other units being in this position here. So also we have the compass that came out of this, which was the compass, which basically translates third dimensional dates, dates on the solar calendar, into purely fourth dimensional dates on the 260-day fourth dimensional calibrator. And this unit has five, six moving wheels on it, and it's literally a digital calculator. There's 18,980 permutations on this little digital calculator. There are 18,000, when you have a 260-day cycle permutation, a 52-year solar cycle, that you have exactly 18,980 days, or 18,980 permutations. We realized that these breakthroughs were happening very quickly with us. We also understood the time cubic as a cubic constant form to it as well, and that the color component was a very key part of the whole mathematical registration. In 1991, we had this produced, late 1991 and 1992, we went to various countries. We went to Germany, we went to Russia. In Russia, we were very well received. We were on state television, and Sunday evening program opened with a close-up of that, and announced it saying we're very happy to have two distinguished North American guests have just returned from a journey to the fourth dimension. We came after going to Russia, Germany, Mexico, and Hong Kong, just testing it out and seeing what kind of initial responses we had to it. We spent some time in Hawaii. We wrote the 13 Moons in Motion, which is basically a primer for understanding exactly how the mathematics of the 13 moon calendar and how it relates to the, what we are coming to call the fourth dimensional timing constant, the 260 unit Tsolkien harmonic module. I also wrote the treatise on time viewed from its own dimension, which was published as the Pakal-Bhutan. Time is the fourth dimension. This is a book incorporates the theory of the biosphere and the biosphere-noosphere transition of Vladimir Vernadsky and goes into a mathematical analysis of the biosphere-noosphere transition, which from our analysis of the 1260-1320 timing frequency and from what Vernadsky had to say about this biosphere-noosphere transition, we saw that we were entering right into it at this time, and that the work that we were doing was a part of the process of the incipient manifestation of the noosphere, the mental sphere that's to be triggered by the transformation of the biosphere once the intermediate stage of the technosphere is completed in its process. And we saw that this was very much the stage that we were in, so all of that work is incorporated in the call of Pakal Bhutan, time is the fourth dimension. That was in 1992 and 93 when we wrote these particular texts. And then we also at that time had called for a time shift and for people to change the calendar. We found out that nobody understood at all anything that we were saying. It was like we realized at that point that we were on the outside of everyone else's aquarium, and they were on the inside, and we were trying to tell them the water was dirty. But they didn't get what we were saying. That was the best way we had of expressing and understanding our feeling, what we were trying to do. And it was very frustrating because we also saw that we have no choice but to continue on with this. We perceived ourselves at this point as being like a set of galactic anthropologists. In order to complete this experiment, we saw that since the 1260 is time is money, and the 1320 is, to put it as simply as possible, time is art, that and in order to complete our understanding that the 1260, by following the 1260 frequency, that the human species had become at odds with its biosphere. In order for us to test this, we had to live in a 1320 way and go around the planet and observe this. So we had a very, very difficult mission, because by this time we had to give up being any part of the money system. We did not have credit cards, we did not have any credit, we did not have mortgage, we did not have anything at all. And yet we had to test this out. We were lucky that we had sets of patrons that would come to us at always at the right moment, someone who would have either sympathy on us, even though they didn't understand what we were doing, which was usually the case. They felt something in our vibration that was worth supporting, even though they did not understand at all what we were doing. And this was pretty much the case. We were living on the Big Island of Hawaii in the summer of 1993, and in a very, very nice style by people who didn't understand what we were doing, but had some sympathetic vibration with us. At that time, on July 26th, the synchronization date in 1993, then I entered into the next phase of this whole process, which was prophetic messengership. And at this point here, I began to decode the final prophecy of Pakal Bhutan. Pakal Bhutan was the Mayan sage who was buried in a tomb in Mexico, and this tomb, the tomb was dedicated in the year 692, 9.13.0.0.0 on the Mayan Long Count, AD 692 on the Christian calendar. This tomb had lay unknown and forgotten until 1952, when it was accidentally, the speaking tube that comes up from the tomb at the bottom of the pyramid to the top of the pyramid was accidentally discovered by the archaeologist Alberto Ruiz. He decided to dig. He dug for 3 years, starting in 1949 to 1952, very painstakingly. He worked his way out and uncovered a whole secret set of stairs that went all the way down, and there found a huge stone, almost trapezoidal-shaped stone door, which he dislodged on the day on June 15th, 1952, and looked in on a massive sarcophagus. A sarcophagus. The lid of the sarcophagus has the image of the what the Russians came to refer to as the astronaut of Palenque. They thought he looked like a cosmonaut. Manning his ship, and through different karmic consequences, the son of the archaeologist Alberto Ruiz, who's also named Alberto Ruiz, came to be a very close friend of ours. We met for the first time. We had correspondence. We met for the first time at his father's tomb. The archaeologist's tomb is right in front of the temple of the inscriptions where this tomb was found. We met there in 1989, and then we became very, very close friends since then. Well, in 1993, through a certain number of experiences, I entered a very, very highly altered state of consciousness in which I remained for about 4 or 5 weeks, decoding information, decoding all this, the hieroglyphs and the information on this, and I realized what it was, and it was the prophecy called Telectonon, which is Earth Spirit Speaking Tube, and it basically confirmed the work that we were doing that says that human race is the only option for the human race, if it is to avoid biospheric collapse, is to shift its timing frequency, and the first step is to get back to the 13 moon calendar. This is a very, very, very profound prophecy. As I said, I was in an altered state for about 4 or 5 weeks, very intensely decoding information about this tomb and making many, many different mathematical diagrams and so on. That resulted from that, and in the midst of that, I said, well, we have to go to Mexico, and this is it. And so that was when we plunged and left off. Our patients gave us $2,000, got us one-way tickets to Mexico, and I said, I told her, I said, I don't know when we'll be back. I don't know where back is going to be when we get back. So we're gone, and I don't know where this is going to take us or how it's going to go. And so we left. We went to Mexico, and in the next 6 months, we had a number of very phenomenal experiences. We got back to the tomb several times. I finished decoding the prophecy of Pakalbutan, the Telectronon, which is now published in this little book here, which I wrote in 9 days. This text, this little text here, is a very profound text. I wrote it in 9 days in Ocotitlan, just north of Amatlan, in the valley where the prophet Quetzalcoatl was born. And I had very specific instruction to go to this house and to live there. It was as primitive a living as you could imagine. It was just a carport that had never seen a car, and someone decided to rent and get money off it as a rented room, but I had very clear instruction I was supposed to go to this specific room and do this, and by candlelight every morning for 9 mornings, I listened to the voice and wrote the prophecy. That was in January of 1994, and then this was also, we predicted the rise of the Zapatistas. We were down there before January 1st, and we said, well, according to this prophecy in 1994, you're going to have the beginning of the Mayan apocalypse. And on New Year's Day, our friends called us up and said, well, there was the big Zapatista uprising in Chiapas, which was only 100 miles from where this tomb is. And we said, well, that's the sign of the Mayan apocalypse. We had, during this period of time, we were on the Vatican and the Mexican government hit list, and we had to travel and lie low. We traveled around South America several times, and we had a number of groups there that had received the Spanish translation of the Dream Stone. So we found a number of little seed groups that we could work with in South America. In the summer of 1994, in the office of Robert Mueller at the University for Peace in Costa Rica, we hatched the World 13 Moon Calendar Change Peace Movement. And we found that that was what the next phase of what we had to do to test this, all of this out, and say, see if there's any popular appeal for this. In what countries is there a popular appeal for this? And so from that, among other things, we hatched the 80 Days Around the World for a New Time of World Peace in 1995. Then we contacted UNESCO about this plan. We did get encouragement from UNESCO and the University for Peace, but that's as far as it went. We ended up going around the world to South Africa, Egypt, Russia, India, Japan, as well as out throughout Latin America and across North America again. And that was when the World 13 Moon Calendar Change Peace Movement was hatched. And after that time, then we held the First Planetary Congress of Biospheric Rights in 1996, and to hammer out what we call the New Covenant, the Biospheric Covenant, which is superposed to Karl Marx, free air, free land, free water is what we all deserve, because that's what the rest of the species have, and if we're living in the right timing frequency, and time is in money, but it's art, that's the way it is. Also that we'll be entering into the new world government of telepathy, which is beyond borders and customs and politics as we know it, and so on. So this is all very radical. We had people from 18 different countries in attendance at this Congress in Brazil in 1996. And from that, then we spent a bit of time also in Japan. We found that Japan was one of the most, in the test, was one of the most receptive countries, because the Japanese culture is very long, very enduring, very stable, and the amount of time that they've been on the Gregorian calendar compared to the long 10,000-year history of the culture is infinitesimally small, and there was a lot of understanding and readiness to hear this. We now have reports. We were in Japan for a very long time last year to complete the World Congress on the Law of Time, and that during this recent time since we left there, of course, you know, the Japanese economy is falling apart. We predicted all of this for them, and there was a prophecy that we came across in Japan had to do with a stupa of pagoda of 13 levels, which is very special, this 13-step pagoda, and we pointed out to Japanese how it referred to these different cycles of time, which ended in 1997. We said after that, when you get to the middle of 1997, you can expect your whole thing to start going down the tubes, which it has been doing. But there, since then, the calendar boom has been growing even more, because as the Japanese get off the materialism thing, they see that the Gregorian calendar is a brief thing, and they're very, very much more receptive to beginning to experiment with the new calendar and the new time. By this time, we had been able to codify all of our understanding of the work we had done, and we realized that what we were dealing with is what we call the discovery of the law of time. The law of time has two aspects. The one aspect has to do with the timing frequencies, that there is a natural timing frequency, which they're codified as 1320, that it has a specific mathematics, which is the fourth dimension of logismal mathematics. Einstein said time is the fourth dimension. That was it, because the mathematics of space cannot be the mathematics of time. The mathematics of time is the mathematics of time, is not the mathematics of space. But time is actually the higher organizing order. That's why understanding this is such a paradigm shift, because we really haven't understood time. The concepts of time that we have now are all, and the measurements of time are all derived from metric linear measurements of space, and so therefore can only create more and more screwy world, and a world that's increasingly out of phase with the biosphere and the natural biological rhythms of evolution. So that's the other aspect of the discovery of the law of time is that as we determine that there is actually what we refer to as the formula of the law of time. Simply and startlingly is this, that T time, energy factored by time equals R. Energy here refers to any third dimensional phenomenon, our DNA, and any forms of energy that are measurable, et cetera, by the third dimensional techniques that we have. That's what we decide for us here, third dimensional component. Time, okay, we now know that the universal galactic time constant is a 1320 frequency. That everything that we observe in nature, that's why we say, wow, nature is so beautiful. Okay, the sunset's beautiful, the animals are beautiful, even when the lion kills the gazelle, it's beautiful. Okay. That all the organizations of the societies of all the different species have a harmony and an order to them, and that they are also, as you observe, all the species within themselves are all in instinctual telepathic communication with each other, because they're all operating unconsciously by the law of time, which is energy factored by time equals R. When your energy is in the right time, even at the unconscious level, that the net result is what we usually refer to as R, a harmonic organized order, okay, a harmonic organized systemic order. That's what art is. So we've been operating as a species with this, and so the result has been that instead of creating art, that we create greater and greater entropy. Okay, instead of our entropy is the increase of ever greater agglomerates of closed systems. Okay, closed information systems. Situation that where the informations are exacerbated by the self-saturation of their own information. So if I say when a new paradigm comes along, no one's even going to know it. Or you're going to be put over in the crazy category or shot. Okay? My life has been threatened and as for pursuing this type of research and communicating this in different parts of the world, that really doesn't bother me because I know what I know, and nothing's going to stop me from expressing what I know and communicating what I know. For that reason, and the sense of being placed in the position of being a messenger, that it's really not even my responsibility to convince any one of you that what I'm telling you is right or wrong. I'm just here to let you know what I've discovered, what I've experienced through my discovery, what I've tested through my discovery, and to let you know that if you're interested, then fine, there's lots of things you can look at, and that you can't seriously dismiss any of this until you can honestly say you've gone and looked at every single last shred of evidence and say you've understood it well enough to dismiss it or to accept it. So that's pretty much what the situation is. I'm here letting you know this because I also feel that this is a very, very critical truth, as Mark put it, that has the potential for reorganizing our perceptions and for reorganizing our human society and actually laying the foundations for a science of the future as radically different as the present science, from the present science as the science of Galileo and Kepler was from the medieval scholasticism that they were reacting against at that time. So as I said, the paradigm shift, when it comes, is going to look very different from what we already know. You can't, and so to begin to understand or even accept something like this, I know it's very difficult. Everybody has a vested interest, consciously or unconsciously, in what they do or in what they know. And that, of course, always makes it even more difficult to understand something new when you're hearing something new, much less to accept that you might even be hearing something new. And I mean this for not only everybody in this room, but for everybody that I've ever talked to about this. The Vatican has their own vested interest in it. The Dalai Lama has his vested interest in it. The scientists have their vested interest, and the bankers and the politicians have their vested interest. The media has their vested interest, and so that's the nature of the reality of the situation. But all I'm saying is that here is what it is, and I do feel that it is critical that you at least get exposed to this and be aware that it's possible that you actually may be looking at the paradigm shift. You may be actually looking at what it looks like. If you can understand that the human species is the only species that's ruining the biosphere, you can't show me another species that's ruining the biosphere. You can't show me another species that also is operating on a separate timing frequency from the biosphere. Okay? And the species that's operating on its own timing frequency is also the species that's destroying the biosphere. So you just start with that, and we say, well, if the timing frequency is what's caused this species to become the cancer of the biosphere, which it is, then what would be wrong with thinking about changing the timing frequency? And if you can see that the incorrect standard of measure, that there is such a thing as a standard of measure, and that there is an incorrect standard of measure of time, and a correct standard of measure of time, that this might be the first very teeny weeny minuscule step, and very practical. This is science that you can put on the table. It's not something that looks like Stephen Hawking's science. Stephen Hawking's, of course, Hawking breaks time's last secret. Well, I'm not sure that that's really true, but because he is who he is, and anything that he says or sneezes about is picked up this way. And this is his theory of time is called open inflation. Sounds like Alan Greenspan's nightmare, but it's Stephen Hawking's theory of time, okay, in which he proposes that before the Big Bang, that the universe was the size of a pea suspended in space, and that somehow or other it got through the Big Bang, and it's now expanding in open-ended inflation. That, of course, is what looks like what we think science is going to look like, some equations. That look like that, okay. But, so we don't think, well, what if the new science actually looked like that? If the new science, that the science of time could actually be a schematic map of history, that it could be a harmonic standard, fourth dimensional standard that looks like this, that has nothing to do with linear mathematics as we know it, that projected into telepathic space looks like this, then we could say this is a very different form of time and science than Mr. Hawking can even dream of at this point. But this is what we, all of this is part of what we are, all of the different proofs that we have put together. In the fall of 1996, we were able to codify this as much as to state what it was, the discovery of the law of time. We were invited by a small group at the United Nations, the Group for Transformation and Spirituality at the United Nations, and so we put this document together for them, which also includes a petition to the United Nations to accept and had to look at this and to accept the discovery of the law of time as part of the human cultural heritage. After that, then, the next thing in terms of the discovery of the law of time was putting together the dynamics of time, the 260 postulates of the dynamics of time as the evolution of consciousness, the set of 260 logical postulates to divide it into 20 different sets, each set having 13 logical steps. And this was written in a very condensed period of time with a very dramatic experience to write, especially if you look at this and consider how logical it is. From this, we've propounded the very, very simple, to some people maybe neo-scholastic, vision of the dynamics of time in which the black hole of God is at the center, and that you have basically an evolution from the quantum dimensional space of pure energy into the third dimensional space, which this part down here comprising the cosmic unconscious, this is the locus of space travel and the development of what we call 1260 civilization. The discovery of the law of time is when we pass from the cosmic unconscious to the cosmic conscious. The law of time makes conscious what was unconscious. You didn't know that you were living in an artificial timing frequency. You didn't know that it was 1260. You didn't know what your clock and your calendar were doing to you. You didn't know that there is a natural harmonic radial matrix that's a fourth dimensional timing standard. You didn't know what fourth dimensional mathematics was. So we passed, and you didn't know what living in the 1260 was doing to your life, to your civilization, and to your planet. So with the discovery of the law of time, then we pass into the cosmic conscious, and you go into the realm of the locus of time travel. This book has a lot to do with what we call time travel, and the entry into fourth dimensional time, and then the return journey back through hyperdimensional time, which is back into pure mind. Time is the fourth dimension, the higher dimension, and the third dimension is the dimension of where the organizing patterns of what you want to call God or the divine source of the original mind, where the organizing patterns of that are pressed into the domain of manifestation. And that also, when we're talking about the evolution of consciousness, we're talking about the different stages of the excitation of stellar phenomena, okay, from their incipient stage to their stage as supernova, and that the supernova stage is actually a stage of very, very hyperdimensional time and consciousness expressing itself and sending different energy and radiations out to lesser evolved planetary and star systems. So that's the basics behind the dynamics of time. We also put together, briefly, the Principia Mathematica of the fourth dimension, which began to state what the basic principles of the 0-19 radial matrix, 12-13-20 radial matrix, what that is about, so it can begin to be understood in a simple mathematical level with reference to the dream spell tools in particular, which are fourth dimensional navigating tools. And then further, we have the pointy tablets of the law of time, which were produced after the dynamics of time was produced. And this is a very, very startling revelation that, again, is highly mathematical in nature. It's a total new dispensation, as it were, of the I Ching and the DNA codons. We know the DNA codons written in the yin-yang language are absolutely no different than the 64 hexagrams of the I Ching, which is one of the points I've been working with in the Earth Ascending. When I've done that, and this kind of comes and doubles back on that. What this basically is shows that over a 16-year, what we're dealing with here is that we're dealing with a 26-year cycle from the harmonic convergence to the 2013. Here's the 2012 closeout date, just before 2013. That we have a 10-year cycle from the harmonic convergence in 1987 to 1997. which is the period of time when we're working on the discovery of the law of time, which is also the period of time of the G7 takeover, the belly of the beast, and the fulfillment of the Vatican's doctrine of discovery. All of that's the apocalyptic judgment day part. Then, beginning in 1997, we have a 16-year cycle that goes from 1997 to 2013. It's a perfect 16-year cycle. And that 16 years is 832 weeks. Mathematically, each of the codons of the DNA, mathematically, is capable of going through a 13-unit permutation cycle. Where you have the one codon starts here, and then you change the bottom line, then you change the next line until you get to the inverse seventh, where you have a mathematically inverse of where you started. And you go back again until in the 13th position, you're back to the same as the first position. So there are 64 codons, there's 13 permutations, 64 times 13 is 832. You have 16 years, 52 weeks a year, 832 weeks a year. So there's a set of codon permutations for every week of the 16-year cycle. We had already begun one telepathic experiment, which is still ongoing, which is the Winry Project experiment in telepathy, which we have teams south of the equator and teams north of the equator who practice sending a magnet to each other in the process of also identifying every 5 days one of their five main chakras with one of the five main points on the planet. This experiment is now in its second year, and we're coasting up to a point in the year 2000, on July 25th, 2000, where the object of the experiment is actually to telepathically, electromagnetically entrain the aurora austral, the aurora borealis, to connect them to create a rainbow bridge. That's why it's called the circumpolar rainbow bridge experiment. And we've said that everyone who thinks this is outlandish, well, they thought the atomic bomb was outlandish when people said, well, if we just smash these little atoms, we'd be surprised at what happened. So we're saying, well, this is no more outlandish than that was. And so this experiment is in full process, as is the experiment right now, what was called cubing the codon, in which every week a different codon is graphically and telepathically created, where you have this on Sunday, you lay down the first line of that codon. It's Monday, the second line of it. By the time you get to Friday, you create all six lines of the codon, the six sides to a cube. You put one line on each side of that cube. And on Saturday, you visualize yourself inside the cube. There's one of 64 runes that codes each of these codons, and you visualize the rune inside of yourself, you inside of the cube. DNA codon, one line of it, of each of which is on one side each of the cube, and then you're sending out the healing vibrations to that particular codon to begin to work with the correction of the genetic code. Okay? And this, what we're doing here literally is putting the DNA code in the correct timing frequency and having a telepathic mental interface with that process. So this process has just begun and will go up until July 25th, 2013. So this is part of what we refer to as being the new science of the fourth dimension. And this is some of the techniques that we have already developed. This is very mathematical, based on all the mathematics of the 1320 time. And it's a very, very, it's an all-encompassing, holistic approach, because you have, on the one hand, you can get very abstract and you can talk about the mathematics of it, but it's also a very practical thing. It's an everyday thing. You do it on your calendar, everyday thing. It's not like an exotic Tibetan Vajrayana visualization where you've got a very, many-armed deity that's blue and got all sorts of things you never saw before. It's just a simple cube. Okay? And it's your DNA that you're dealing with. And it's very, very simple exercises like that. Well, I'm just here to give you just this overview. As I said, as far as I'm concerned, for me, I don't know if it's for anyone else, This is a historic moment because I actually got enough people to sit down long enough, so I think have at least some intelligence to have some idea of what it is I'm talking about. I might have some intelligence to figure out how it might begin to impact on what they know, and then maybe might be able to see how actually we can begin to communicate this into a larger society, or maybe just to incorporate into what we're doing and make ever widening circles of comprehension of this discovery. Because as I said, the blackout on people knowing about this is very big, and the only way we're going to know about it at this point, it seems, is by people who have intelligence, who have, I think, have some sense of, or are willing to look at it, or willing to go deeper into it and see how it relates with what they're doing. I had the opportunity a little bit. I know Ralph somewhat, and I know I had a little opportunity to look at some work that Nassim has done, and particularly with your work, Nassim, I found it very, very complimentary and no real conflict from what I understood of what your mathematical modeling is about and what we're talking about. Basically, what we're saying is that time is the fourth dimension. The mathematics of the fourth dimension is a vagissimal mathematics. We're talking about something that's radically nonlinear. We're talking about also mathematics that's based on a radial matrix. We're talking also about a now-centered cosmology. Okay, Charles, he called zero-point Vernadsky. Vladimir Vernadsky, who did all the pioneering work on the biosphere, gave us the biggest clue in our work. And in the end of his work on the biosphere, just before he died in 1944, he said that we know everything we need to know about the biosphere except what we don't know about time. He said all of our concepts, and he's the only modern scientist as far as I knew, got this far, all of our concepts of time are based on metric measurements of space. And that just won't cut it because the biosphere, you can't deal with it in that way. And so we have to have a radically different kind of mathematics. And he said, all I can tell you about it is this, that from the point of view of time, space is an infinitely locatable point. And I understand that very well, because from the point of view of the dynamics of time, space is an infinitely locatable point capable of registering an infinite number of time vector potentialities. The time vector potentialities have to do with the augment of our intelligence and our consciousness by understanding the different mathematical ratios that tie all of our different experiences together. Synchronicity can actually be mapped, and the maps of synchronicity are radial matrices. And as I said this morning, and I've said elsewhere, that when we understand this completely, we will see that synchronicity is to the fourth dimensional science of telepathy and time what lightning is to electricity. And that's the real promise and the potential of what we're presenting here. So that's basically what I have to say about this. We did put together some material that we wanted everybody to have, and so I want to make sure that.
Well, I could just speak to this point of saying in the desire to have a serious dialogue and to open up this process, we would like to offer this as a gift. Each person would like to undertake this study, and that we would make a commitment to possibly meet again, and that we need to actually establish a circle of people willing to dialogue at the level to refine.
Mayan work versus astrology, and in around the mid-60s, astrology birthed itself, and it seemed to have a profound identity shift for people. Could you say anything about that?
No, he said nothing to do with astrology.
Well, no, but I mean, is there a similar birthing, or is it of expanded knowledge of oneself? Astrology seemed in the 60s to have a
I see where you're going. But I'd say this is like, this is a comment you're talking about. I'd say it's much more like LSD in the 60s, okay? This the LSD really changed the consciousness in the 60s, and that's what science of time, this what we're talking about.